everybody, and welcome to our postgraduate online event for our environmental subjects here at the University of Glasgow's Dumfries campus, home to the School of Social and Environmental Sustainability. My name is Amy, I'm part of the team here, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about our school and our campus, and I'm joined by colleagues and current student today to tell you a little bit more about studying at the University of Glasgow's Dumfries campus on our environmental subject and programmes. So, first of all, let's tell you a little bit more about our school. As I said, we are the School of Social and Environmental Sustainability at the University of Glasgow's Dumfries campus. So we are based in Dumfries in southwest Scotland, approximately 75 miles from the city of Glasgow. And we are the third largest region in the whole of Scotland. And we are based here in Dumfries on 85 acres of campus. It's beautiful parkland here in Dumfries. And we typically welcome staff and students every year from around 40 countries from around the world and the UK. So we're very, very lucky here on campus to have so many wonderful people joining us from all across the world. We are surrounded by what we like to call the living laboratory of Dumfries and Galloway that surrounds our campus. So we make use of that, especially in our environmental subject programmes. And this includes our teaching garden. So you can see that on your screen right now, which is literally on our back doorstep, but right behind the Rutherford Cowan building here on campus. And that's used for learning and teaching, for study space, for research, and for social space and events as well. But using the entire laboratory that we have around us, we have coast, rivers, forestry, agriculture, everything you could possibly want as an environmental student here in the region. And it's 10, 15 minutes away. You know, it's very, very close by, everything we could possibly want throughout the region. But we do make sure and cover the entire region and even further afield as well. We pride ourselves on having smaller class sizes here at Dumfries, which means you not only get to know your fellow classmates, your peers, your friends in your classes, but also your lecturers. So your lecturers will really get to know you as a person, what motivates you, what drives you, why are you doing this programme, and ultimately what is your end goal and how can we support you? We really get to know you and make sure we give you the best possible support that we can. We're a really close-knit community here in Dumfries and at the school. And being a Russell Group institution, our academics are among the top researchers in their fields. So you are learning from some truly fantastic people. So, about our subject areas as a whole. So as a school, we cover four main subject areas, which are environmental science, sustainable development, education, and tourism. So we're going to focus today in this session on our environmental subjects across the board, and we'll find out a little bit more about them in just a second. But just to point out, I always like to make note of our research that we have here at the campus as well. So when you join the School of Social and Environmental Sustainability, you gain access to a collective of world-leading research networks, and they're at the very forefront of their respective fields. So we have groups based here like the Education Interdisciplinary Research Group, the Environmental Science and Sustainability Team, the Glasgow End of Life Studies Group, and the University of Glasgow Tourism Studies Group as well. All of these right here at your disposal for you to, you know, collaborate with, join in with, find out what they're up to, and also potential routes if you wanted to do further study, for example, after your master's, go on to do your PhD or postgraduate research, and you have plenty of opportunities for that as well. So enough from me, let's find out a little bit more about what we can offer here at the University of Glasgow's Dumfries campus in environmental science and sustainability. I'm with Dr. Natalie Weldon. Natalie, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, Amy. Thanks for having me.
I'll let you tell us a little bit more about what students can expect if they come to study one of our environmental subjects here in Dumfries.
Hi everyone, it's really, really nice to be with you here today. As Amy has said, I'm Dr. Natalie Weldon. I work on a couple of the different degree programmes here, both undergraduate and postgraduate, and I'm also a researcher within the school. I work on pollution and its impacts in different settings, particularly in aquatic environments. And one of the fields that I'm super interested in is things like plastics and microplastics. Feel free to ask me any questions about those, as well as about the courses as we go through. And I'm sure that Amy will collate those questions for me afterwards. So, yeah, Amy's given me between 5 and 15 minutes to talk to you about our various postgraduate environmental programmes today. And I'm really, really excited to do so. Some of you might be coming in with different backgrounds, different interests, and obviously the programmes that we've got on offer at the moment or coming up, as I'll discuss in a second, are environment, culture and communication, environmental risk management, and environmental ecology and environmental monitoring as well. So why might you be coming to us for these questions? Well, there are a whole host of different backgrounds and regions and approaches that kind of come under the umbrella of environmental science. I don't think that I need to sit here and tell you, with your probable backgrounds, if you're interested in these courses, just how much trouble we are in worldwide. And a lot of those issues, a lot of those problems are right here captured under those global sustainable development goals. A lot of you will have been absolutely worn out listening to these in your undergraduate degree program. However, what you need to think about when you're coming onto one of our programs is these are the programs that directly address a lot of these problems and issues. And the way that you can help to tackle these problems will vary a little bit depending on the programs that we're in. But within these programs in environment and sustainability, we'll be looking at the things that influence poverty, hunger, our ability to function healthily as both individuals and communities. We will help to raise your level of understanding so that some of you can go on and tackle those education problems in the area as well. We also know that inequalities and sustainability issues are incredibly linked to things like gender equality. I don't need to talk about clean water and sanitation and the changes that we have on the environment and the way that factors in to those overall. Affordability with clean energy, that goes without saying as well. The way that we generate our power, whether it is by renewables or via fossil fuels or other methods, has a huge knock-on effect on our environmental footprints and the apparent risks to ourselves and biological communities as a result of that. Again, within these fields of sustainable growth, there are whole new careers that can be developed and influences on both local economic growth, if you're looking at single case study areas, global GDP, and other factors worldwide in terms of economic development. The way that we structure our new cities, the way that we grow over time, is hugely linked to the way that we interact with the environment around us, both in terms of the resources we use and where and how we build. Again, addressing those wider inequalities, building those sustainable communities, and if you're interested in the plastics problem like me, looking at things like sustainable consumption and production. The three big hitters as far as we're concerned, climate change, life below water, life on land, absolutely fantastically linked and embedded into all of these topics, but also things like peace and justice and strong institutions. If you look across the world in terms of things like water security, particularly in conflict zones, the way accessibility of resources is distributed can have a huge effect on already stressed areas in terms of how we develop overall. And then how we work together. Now, as I go and talk through the various aspects of the different degrees, you'll see that we're coming to these environmental issues from a range of different angles just within this one subset of courses. Within this, we can have a look at how people from different backgrounds with different interests and different skill sets can work together to make sure that we have a sustainable future. Now, not to make too many generalizations about you guys and where you're going to be coming from, where you want to work. But I would suggest that typically those students that are coming in to work in this area, whether you're more involved in the communication and policy side, or whether you are interested in the science, whether that's impacts on humans in terms of environmental risk or on the wider environment, those communities that are out there, those ecosystems in terms of ecology and environmental monitoring, a lot of you will have that keen interest in nature. You might be worried about our impact on the environment on the whole. You might just be drawn to being outside in those settings and looking to develop those skills in a career that enables you to be outside and in the field. You might be interested in those big global challenges that I've discussed before, worried about social inequalities, or you might already be out in the working environment. You might be working for an NGO. You might be working for an organizational body like a policymaker or regulator and looking to formalize some of those skills. Or you might just be really passionate about the environmental sciences on the whole. We get a whole different mix of people every year with different end goals and career routes in mind. And the nice thing is about our staff members here, you've got people with a range of research backgrounds as well as previous experience of working in these careers who, depending on what your aims and goals want to be, can help you to reach those targets overall. So let's start to look at some of these degree programs in a little bit more detail. I won't spend too much time here. Obviously, I teach on a couple of them. This is the one that I don't. This is Environment, Culture and Communication, which is led by my amazing colleague, Dr. David Borthwick. Obviously, like all of our programs, it's 12 months full time or 24 months part time. And the whole purpose of this degree is to understand how we relate to the environment, how we value the environment, as well as how we discuss those values between ourselves, how we communicate things like risk. And that may be at the incredibly formal level, the policymaker side, regulators, and that kind of communication around environment, or it might be around the more arts and abstract side as well. And there are these two different approaches that you can take throughout this course. And this is kind of, I'm pointing like the slides are behind me. They're always behind me when I'm working. This is reflected in the core courses for this particular route. So within these core courses, you must take either the environmental comms course and you can do both, of course, environmental politics and society. So if you're coming from a very arts focused background and that's your interest, you can take that communication route. If you are interested in policy, science side, and communicating those issues more broadly to potentially stakeholders, you can take that politics and society route, or you can combine for the two. As part of this course, you'll be learning from a mix of backgrounds. So we have lecturers with that interest in policy, in the social sciences side, in ethics and behavioral change. So my friends, Dr. Ben Franks and Stuart Hanscom, as well as from a range of other organizations in the area, whether they are both voluntary groups, whether it's national parks, whether it's arts organizations. And Dumfries and Galloway is an incredible place to study these things because not only does it have a wealth of natural resources and that connection to the landscape, it has a well-established arts and culture background. I won't go too much into it. Look up things like the Wild Goose Festival and other bits and pieces. You'll be sure to pick those up. If you're more interested in the sciencey side rather than the comms side, your first option is environmental risk management. Now, I like to split the two sciencey courses as environmental problems and how they impact humans via environmental change, which is environmental risk management, and environmental problems that we're causing and how that impacts ecosystems, habitats, species, biodiversity, which is the course that I'll come onto in a minute. Within this first course, environmental risk management, we are very much focused on understanding natural hazards, how they manifest in the environment, how we as human communities are exposed to those hazards, and how we can predict where they're going to occur, how we understand who's going to be affected, how bad that's going to be, and how we might mitigate some of those problems overall. Here, the core courses are our research methods course, responding to risks in aquatic environment, which is clearly the best course on there because it's mine, responding to risks in terrestrial environments. It's not watery enough, in my opinion. And then theories, practice and policies, environmental risk and management as well. And obviously, on top of these core courses, we have options that I'll come to in a second. Again, being here in this environment is an incredibly great place to be. If you have another tab or something up at the same time, wait until I've finished speaking, but just Google very quickly Dumfries floods. And you'll see a good idea of what's going on in terms of local risks. But also we've got a wider environment to use as well. As Amy said, Dumfries and Galloway is an enormous area, and that gives us a lot of scope for taking people out into the field and showing both manifestations of these risks and how they're managed. We can also nip down over the border to my home country of England and have a look at some of the differences there as well. And it's all about giving you hands-on experience of measurement and then looking at how that relates to ongoing management and those policy interventions as well. Skipping on ahead, and I know that there's a lot to cover here, I'm very sorry, but Amy's only given me 15 minutes. There is ecology and environmental monitoring, and this is new for 2024, and I'm incredibly excited because this is my baby. The whole purpose of this course is to provide you with the skills that are necessary to both understand what's going on in the environment and what we can do to protect it in greater detail. So human impacts on the environment and those knock-on effects to communities. I want to create graduates that are confident and competent that they can go out into the field, they can identify what's there effectively, wherever you're from in the world. So obviously we use a lot of local examples, but they're also linked to globally relevant case studies as well. So I want you to be able to understand the fundamentals of taxonomy and population monitoring. You can't see behind me, but I've just spent the last year ordering umpteen different bits of kit for monitoring different environmental groups and taxa, from mammals and other megafauna down to the really tiny fungi, microorganisms, diatoms, all of those other bits and pieces. So you'll be learning the principles of ecology, environment and conservation. You'll have a 40 credit module that spans the two taught semesters of taxonomy and population monitoring, which will be outside a heck of a lot. Research methods again, and then, as I'll come on to, or I might just skip straight onto it now, as with the other courses, a placement or dissertation option. Of course, when you're taking your core courses, there's obviously a whole host of different options that you can take. Now, some of you might have an interest in environmental communication, but you're also really keen on being outside and getting to grips with those environments, understanding how they work so that you can better communicate those changes. Don't think that going down the communication route means that you can't come out and play. Likewise, if you want to do the sciences route, but you are interested in SciComm as a potential output, or you're interested in working at the research policy nexus or somewhere between the two, you can't do the others. So you have the ability to pick and choose between the core courses on other programs and a whole host of other courses beside. As I mentioned a second ago as well, you have the opportunity in the third semester to do either a dissertation or placement. This is your opportunity to demonstrate your academic independence, to take those foundational skills that we've given you, both the practical and that research-led theory, and to show that you're ready to go out and run with this, whether you take on a dissertation or a placement. And even if you do take the dissertation route, doesn't matter what program you're in, that doesn't mean that you can't do a project on behalf of an external organization or use external organizations' data, whatever that might be. If you're very, very career focused and you're hoping that you're going to get a master's to go the careers route, do something that's relevant to where you want to go. If you want to do something that's very research led as you move on and you leave us, then absolutely fine with that as well. You can absolutely go that way. You can explore new research avenues, and you might even be able to get a paper published out of it at the end. We'd be delighted if you did. So yes, there's a lot that you can get on with there. Now, we've already talked about some of these settings, but they are incredible. There's a whole host of different protected environments. We've got a whole range of different species that are impacted in lots of different ways. And there are a lot of industries that are linked to the environment in Dumfries and Galloway. So, for example, things like forestry, agriculture, rural tourism, and these all come together to create an incredible mosaic of different settings in which we can place you and let you try out those skills overall. Additionally, if you are working in the building with us and working on those lines, you can also use our laboratory facilities if you're doing something a bit sciencey, to get to grips with how these changes are impacting those smaller factors, those abiotic changes, those population scale changes, and you can look at things like organism and behavioral responses as well. Now, I've talked about Dave Borthwick already, who leads our environmental culture and communication course. There's also Dr. Sawa Hossain, who heads up the environmental risk management course, and I will be leading up the ecology and environmental monitoring program. But you will also, as I've suggested before, learn from an incredibly close-knit but diverse range of researchers and lecturers in your field who also work really, really closely with industry in the field. So you're not just going to be learning directly from us, you'll also link to the different groups that are both in the region and further afield as well as part of that program. Just a couple of them are on screen now. And you can have a look at our individual profiles and contact any of us, because our contact details are online if you're interested in any aspects of what we do. Or if you have the time, come see us in Dumfries and Galloway. We'd love to see you in person if you have the opportunity. But if you do have any questions right now or anything about the wider living in Dumfries and Galloway, I'd be really happy to answer them. And Amy, that's me.
Thank you so, so much. Just fantastic information there. Thank you. Yes, absolutely. If you have any questions, please send them in to us just now. We have so many already, so I cannot wait to dive into these. But any more, don't be shy. Please send them in. You can use the text chat on YouTube or you can go to slido.com and use the code #UofG, and we will do our very, very best to get some of those answers to you. But for now, I am so delighted to welcome one of our current students, who is on our environmental risk management programme. Thank you so much for joining us today. So it's so lovely to have you. Would you just introduce yourself just a little bit and tell us a little bit more about your experience on the programme?
Okay, hi Amy. Thank you for having me. And I am I'm Swati, and I'm a current student in the PGT Environmental Risk Management course in University of Glasgow Dumfries campus. And also you might have met the Professor Natalie Weldon. She's actually teaching me one of the core courses called the Responding to Risk in Aquatic Environment. So it's barely been like 2 months since I've been here. So far it's been great, because like, first of all, it's been my first time leaving my country, and it's been like new experience, new place, new people. It was quite, thrilling and exciting at the same time. But so far, when you talk about the experience, is that, it's been great. Like, I have really good professors here who are there to help. The staffs are super friendly. And it's different from the main campus, University of Glasgow, because compared to the main campus, Dumfries is like a really calm, beautiful, and like a peaceful place with like a really good small group of community. Like, we have like, there's a reason why we have all the environmental science courses in Dumfries, because it's like a very friendly environment. We have a lot of places to explore, like how Natalie and like Amy would have mentioned in their presentations. So one thing I would like to say is that, like, if you're taking environmental science course, like, you can see world is changing, climate change is real, and we've seen a lot of things happening right now, and you know how serious it is. So it is actually important that a lot of people come and, focus on these kind of subjects. And we have already really interesting course in environment science, like environmental culture and communication. We have environmental tourism, risk management. Now there's a new course coming, which is also very interesting, ecology, which is a mix of ecology and environmental monitoring. I'm previously from an environmental science background myself. Like, I did a master's in environmental science before, but since I was confused and didn't know which field to jump into, I was interested in disaster management. So that's why I took environmental risk management. But I'm also interested in ecology and everything. So when I heard about the new course, I was like, wow, if I would have taken a year, skipped a year, I would have gotten to work, like, you know, study in that course. But so far, like, my 2 months has been great. Like, we already started our classes, we got it, got our assignments too. And like, the classes are all very, you know, balanced, and it's quite flexible for international students like myself, because for me, like, being an international student, we have a lot to get adjusted to, and we have a really friendly community here, both in Dumfries and in our campus. We have really good friendly staffs here who would help you whenever you are in need. And I believe that, you know, once you get here, it's pretty, like, you know, I don't think that you're going to face a hard time, because you have people here to help you. You have really good classmates here. Like, you know, it's diverse. There are people coming from all over the globe. Like, in my class, I have a lot of people from China, India, and I have my batchmates who are from the US, Indonesia, Bangladesh. And, you know, you can see the cultural difference. You get to know people more, and you able to explore also, since, you know, the classes are flexible. You mostly, depending on the courses that you choose, like the core and electives, you have classes like 2 or 3 days a week. So other times you can, you know, you can work on part-time jobs if you're working for that, or if you can explore, because you're in the west, southwest Scotland, you have the beautiful views here, and you're somewhere around. So, you know, one just grab a, like, you know, bus ticket and just, you know, explore. That's one thing I would like to say. So for now, it's been great. So yeah.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm so glad that's been your experience. And it sounds like you're having just a wonderful time, which is so great to hear. And yeah, thank you so much for sharing. I mean, we have so many questions. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring Dr. Natalie Weldon. I'm going to bring Natalie back on screen. Hi.
Hi.
We're going to fire through some of these questions. We have so many coming in, so thank you so much. Keep sending them in. We're here to answer your questions, so please keep sending them in. But let's bring up our first one here. So do we share classes with others from any other programs? So both of you have kind of touched on this, but should we explore this a little bit more?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I'd highly recommend it, actually, because I think it helps to get really nicely rounded graduates. So, I mean, at the moment, Swathi, what's your mix of courses? Obviously, you've got me as a core course.
Yeah.
So what else are you taking?
And I actually took my elective on ecology, environment and conservation, because that's what I stole. I took the elective for ecology. So when I saw the new course, I was like, damn, it's like a mix of my two favorites. So, like, yeah, I share I have a elective course that is the environment, like ecology and conservation. So I have a few of my friends from environment, culture and communication who's sharing course with me. So mostly some elective courses we share among the other batch of students also. So yeah, we do interact with more people when it comes to electives. And also there are some courses, and I've also had an opportunity to go for a field work which was organized for the environmental, culture and communication people last week. So, you know, there are a lot of times when you interact and share classes and field works and all. So it's been great.
That's fun. Oh, yeah, no, I really like that it is so flexible. So typically in a semester, you'll have the opportunity to take at least one elective from another program as part of your course. It depends exactly what the credit makeup of your individual degree is. But yeah, have a look at what the options are via our University of Glasgow pages. And if you've got any interest, find out who's leading it and ask them questions.
Definitely. And well, speaking of other programs, I am so delighted to let you guys know that we are joined by another current student. Hi, welcome. We weren't completely sure. We had class today. We've had a busy day of classes. So thank you so much for taking the time to join us. And it's great to have you here. Do you want to very quickly just introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your experience? And then we'll go back to some more questions.
Yes, of course. So hi, everyone. I am Brenna McClellan, and I am one of the students on the Environment, Culture and Communication Master's Program here at Dumfries. Our program is very interdisciplinary, so we cover a range from literature to environmental ethics to behavior, to even getting into some of the stuff that Swati was talking about with some of the more risk management stuff, but that's usually through our electives. As I said, it's very interdisciplinary, and that's one of the reasons why I chose the program. And so far, I've been in love with the topics, and the staff is very, very helpful and very clear, which helps with that approach with interdisciplinary studies.
Oh, thank you so much. It's so great to have everyone here, all of our environmental programs represented. So thank you so much. It's great to speak with you all. So next question we have here for us all is, do we get much time to talk to lecturers? So we've talked about class sizes, you know, being a little bit smaller to give you a bit more time. But I mean, what's your experience, guys? Is this true?
I would agree with my program. As I kind of just mentioned, the staff is very, the faculty members are very responsive to students. I feel very comfortable approaching any of my lecturers about any of the questions I have, and it's just been very welcoming. So being a small class size, you do get that close knit and support from your lecturers.
Yeah, I agree with the I agree with Brenna, because, you know, even for us, like, we have a small class group, like, so in that case, we can not only interact with our own classmates, but we can also have a lot, like, the professors and our faculty members can also interact with us more. There are times when, you know, a few of our, classmates joined late. So there were times when the lecturers were like, you know, they can have a separate time with us, and, you know, they always reach out to us. So that's one thing, like, we have time. Like, there are times when they are busy, they also make sure that, you know, that they would, you know, spare time for us, so they tell us to, you know, let them know prior so that you can arrange time for them. So yeah, we do get much time to talk to the lecturers.
Fantastic, thank you guys so much. Okay, Natalie, here's one for you. Can we see any reading lists before we start classes?
It depends. Now, some of the reading lists are available via things like the Moodle pages, which are for once you are enrolled. But some courses will identify things like key course texts. If you can't see that information on one of the course pages, one of the program pages, sorry, rather than course pages, just get in touch with the person who's leading that program, and they'll be able to tell you a little bit about the text that they use. For example, environmental ethics and behavioral change is predominantly the course text is Drs. Franks, Hanscom, and Johnston's book, Environmental Ethics and Behavioural Change. So some of them are kind of implied. I'm waiting for my own books to come out so I can base an entire course around them. But yeah, so it will vary depending on the programmes and the individual courses. But by the time if you are joining us, if you are signed up for Moodle, which is where we store all of our slides and our learning materials, you'll be able to see those at the start of the term. Now, one of the things that we all try to do as lecturers is use learning materials that have electronic access. There is nothing worse than having to buy 100 textbooks and having nothing to do with them when you've finished your degree. So a lot of the time, the University of Glasgow's libraries have access to e-versions of the textbooks. And I know that I, and along with most of my colleagues, will try to use those resources if we can. Now, it's not possible for all of our courses, for example, things like some of the history related courses have books that are not transferred across to e-materials, just because of how old they are, in which case we'll try and get you electronic copies from some other way, but we do our best. There we go.
Definitely. No, absolutely. Thank you so much. Okay, next question here. How much time will we have to explore Dumfries and Galloway or Scotland as a whole? Great question.
I mean, I can talk about it. It goes along the lines of it's dependent on your schedule. This semester, I've had quite nice for exploring. So I only have classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays, which leaves Fridays and Mondays free. And that gives you ample time to go explore Dumfries and Galloway and even other parts of Scotland. Just last week, a group of us went up and over to Edinburgh for the Samhain Festival. And so you do get these times and you get to explore Scotland and things are connected here. Being from the States, you don't have that much option unless you have a car. I will say in Dumfries and Galloway, it's a little bit nice to have a car, but it is doable not to have a car. There is still plenty of things to do and explore.
Yeah, we have like access to the transport here. Like we have the bus station here and the train. Like, and we have a lot of places to explore here because Dumfries and Galloway, like it's different from where how we come in from our cities and all. It's like in the outskirts, so we have a lot to explore. And there's a lot of cultural, as we have a cultural, good cultural background here. Like we have like, because like a place of Robert Byrne, and there's a lot of festivals happen here. So it's like a great place to explore.
So I'm going to plug my own program off the back of that. Obviously, with the field trips, you do get to go out, and I've given some examples of some of the places that you might go to. With the new program, obviously, there's a lot of emphasis on being able to go to different habitats and identify what's there. And to do that, we need to go outside. So we're going to spend a lot of time in the minibus in the first term, first semester. And then as we get into semester two, we've got some slightly longer, kind of long weekend style field trips to, we're planning at the moment, subject to change, the Isle of Cumbrae, which is in the Clyde Sea. It's just north of the Isle of Arran. It's actually where I did my PhD and I love it very much, as well as the Scottish Centre for Ecology and the Natural Environment, which is SEEN, which is owned by the University of Glasgow, but it's based up near Loch Lomond as well. So those are our planned trips for the second semester of the master's year. But of course, I like playing outside. It's why I designed that degree. So I try and take people out to play on my other courses as well. So we've done a little bit of that so far on aquatics for the risk management course. Yeah. And I like to do playing outside wherever.
I will also say too, for field trip wise, because we are so small, and we are such a tight-knit community, we have opportunities to go on field trips from different programs. So, for example, next week, the tourism students are going to Loch Ken, but I have been invited because there's space to go on the field trip. So the field trips do provide a lot of opportunity to explore. And just because your program isn't doing it doesn't mean that there's not space in others, and the faculty are very transparent when opportunities for field trips come up. Just last Friday, the environment culture communication students went to the Trossachs in Loch Lomond, and Swati actually joined us. So there's a lot of that whole sharing experiences amongst the programs.
That's absolutely fantastic. That sounds so much fun, and I can't wait to hear about your trip next week. That sounds fantastic. So, oh, thank you so much for sharing, guys. That's brilliant. Plenty of opportunity to explore. Okay, is it possible to go straight from my undergraduate degree into postgraduate study?
So master's level, absolutely. If you've got the grades, we'll take you. If you are coming in from an alternative route, if you've been in the field for a while or been in a career for a while and you've got work-related experience, if it's relevant, we'll take you. So we're not expecting people to come in with tons of experience of doing the things that we're teaching. It's all about building your confidence in those skills, introducing new skill sets, and getting you to the point where you're ready to launch yourself either into a really focused career or into research, depending on what your tastes might be.
Ah, amazing. Thank you so much. Okay, next question here. Are there any scholarships available? I'm going to jump in on this one because there's a really useful tool that I love telling people about, which is on the University of Glasgow's website, and it's a scholarship finder, essentially. So you can go on to glasgow.ac.uk/scholarships. I'll pop it up on the screen just now. There it is. And you can go to this site. There's a tool where you can basically put in the level you're studying at, where you are in the world, or you know, or what program you're going to be studying, and it will essentially find for you some options of potential scholarships that you could apply for that is relevant to either, like I say, your program or where you are in the world, or the level of study that you're doing. It lets you basically find yeah, anything that you might be able to apply for. It's a really, really useful tool. So I would highly recommend, if you can, have a look at this site. And of course, the scholarships team at the university are fantastic as well. So you can always reach out if you have any questions or worries. Just reach out to them. They are really, really helpful. But I mean, I don't know if anyone else wants to say anything on scholarships, but I think that tool is my favorite. So if you can, I would recommend doing that. Cool. Okie doke. Next question. Can you tell us more about the field work on the Ecology and Environmental Monitoring Programme, please? Will we get to do the practical skills ourselves?
Absolutely. I'm far too lazy to do all of that work. No. The whole point is to get you doing these things. So that might be acoustic monitoring for bats, looking at emergence and their diversity at different sites. It might be camera trapping for things like pine marten and escaped wild boar populations and badgers in the Galloway forest. It could be looking, like I said, at diatoms, how to treat those samples. Obviously, those are a huge part of monitoring for river health if you're going into the regulatory side of environmental management. Small mammal trapping, like I say, looking at different plant communities. I'm basically going to stand there and have a lovely coffee in a beautiful environment, having obviously first demonstrated things, whilst you get yourself out there and going. So in the first couple of weeks, we will look at how to design sampling regimes so that you are capable of going out into these environments and putting in place a suitable sampling regime. Before we go out into the field, we'll talk about how we should be sampling. You can set out the parameters for where and how many samples you're going to take. And then when we get to the site, it's all about me demoing what you're going to be doing that day. And then it's all about you guys doing it. Otherwise, what's the point in taking you?
Yeah, absolutely. No, that's fantastic. And I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but having the kind of smaller class size that we have will mean that students actually get more opportunity to have the time to get hands-on, and you know, you're not going to be waiting in a queue of 50 other students to get your turn. We'll actually just be able to get out there and get stuck in.
Absolutely. Our guys in purchasing are a little bit fed up with me buying equipment now as well. So there's plenty to go around. But yeah, we'll be getting lots of samples, put it that way. And there will be lots of opportunities for you to work your little socks off in the beautiful Scottish environment.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Okie doke, we have a question here about environmental risk management. How global is the environmental risk management programme? Do we learn about risks across the world or just specific places?
So I know that Swathi might jump in on this in a minute from some of her courses, but from my perspective, from the aquatic risks, what we do is we demo stuff that's happening here in Dumfries, but is also relevant globally. Now, there are some things that either aren't quite always relevant to the global scenario, like we don't have a lot of big drought effects that I can show off, for example. We're a little bit low on large rogue waves as well, thankfully, where we are. But what we try and do is we use local case studies that are relevant to the global field, and also within your assessments, give you scope to look at how these events are occurring in the wider environment too. So there's that mix.
Fantastic. Yes, I agree. Because we have the courses, like we have one in the, mostly we deal with the theoretical parts. We deal with all the global issues like the Japan tsunamis, then all the land, all the risks that are assessed on a global basis. We do address all of it in our courses. But mostly when it comes to our field work, mostly we have done field work in and around Scotland, and most of it, like one of our field work was in the Dumfries town center because our Nith River is known to get flooded once in a while every year. And we also had a field work just a few weeks ago with Natalie in Silith, Cumbrian, around the coast of England for studying the coastal erosion and everything. So yeah, when it comes talking about how global the risk management program is, like we do address a lot of globally challenging issues that are going on. But when it comes to field work, I think we are mostly focused on the ones which are in the close proximity. So, yeah.
Oh, thank you so much. That's brilliant. Thank you. Okay, next question here. Oh, it's one for you, Brenna. Okay, so can you tell me a little bit more about what you want to do after environment, culture, and communication?
Yes, that's always the question, right? Well, it is a, so since it is a master in literature, it's a common, I know, inquiry for most people. For myself personally, I have a background in education, and so I would like to take it into the realm of environmental education. I've thought to even continue to be onto like professor sorrelship, excuse me, university level. But at the moment, I am really focused on environmental education. And with this MLitt and with this program, we do get introduced quite a bit of theory. So it's now, how am I going to apply this to my area of field? And that's one of the things that is nice about this master's program is that you can be coming in from, you know, from a literary side or communication side or an environmental science side, because you're getting tools that you can use outside. It is that some of it will be on you to apply it to, but since it is so broad and we do cover so much, you can bring it to so many different fields and professions. So I might, like I said, I would bring it to environmental education, where my fellow colleagues might bring it to communications or into more of science and seeing how to actually frame different academic papers, just so that we are actually covering the concepts that we talk about in the course. So.
Amazing. No, thank you so much. That sounds incredible. Okay, final question that we've got time for one more, which is, can we do placements internationally? So Natalie, I think this is one for you.
So this will vary depending on courses. There is guidance depending on any type of placement, and there are lots of risk assessment elements that will be involved. That can be a little bit of a barrier sometimes at master's level. For my program, I'm not against it at all. If we can get all the risk assessment sorted, if we can get that in place for you in the very short amount of time between you starting your initial master's degree and when it comes to around April to go and start your placement, I don't have a problem with that whatsoever, but it does vary. So talk to the program director for your various programs and double check if that's something that you're really interested in. As far as I'm concerned, go out and play, make me really jealous with loads of photos of beautiful locations, and send me back a fantastic report of what you've been up to.
Fantastic, fantastic advice. Thank you so much. And speaking of advice, I wondered if I could ask our two students very quickly if you had any advice you could give to students who are, you know, we're talking to people who were last year, you know. So if you could give advice to any students right now who are watching this, who are thinking, you know, thinking about postgraduate study, particularly environmental field, any advice you could give to them about coming to study at the University of Glasgow, what would you say?
You can go first. Okay. I know this came up as a question. I personally would say, you know, because the environmental field is so big, maybe don't go straight to your postgraduate degree. See what's out there. I know my personal story. I have gone from thinking I might do philanthropy to policy to science, and it wasn't until I actually got experience within the field of environmental education that I knew that this is where I fit into this niche, because we do get a lot of times, you know, green jobs are that big umbrella, and sometimes it's hard to know exactly what to study or even to focus when you are given the opportunity, which you are in my program, to come up with these creative ideas. It's sometimes a challenge when you've not had that experience to pull those ideas. So my advice would be, if you're not fully certain on what you want to do, maybe see what's out there and investigate a little bit before fully committing to your master's.
Yeah, even I agree, because I already did a 2-year master's in environmental science before coming here. That's the thing which I face, because this, it's like a wide field, environmental science. It's an interdisciplinary field. So there's a lot to explore. There's this disaster management, there's environment and conservation, environmental monitoring. Then there's a different part related to policies and everything. And there's environmental journalism, literature, and there's like a wide field. So I was someone who's interested to go, you know, travel, explore. And, you know, I love photography. I love to go do ecology and all. But I am also worried about the impacts, and I want to be a part of disaster, like, you know, work on disaster management and contribute to a change, like change in the world. So that's how I ended up looking into the courses here, and that's how I ended up in taking risk management. And as I've seen, we have a lot of professional lecturers with us who's gonna guide you through, and they're gonna help you. But as Brenna mentioned, like, you know, you have to do a thorough research before you finalize on which field of environmental science you're gonna end up. And as you can see here in the School of Environment and Sustainability, we have a lot of courses all in different, like, which touches different parts of the environmental topics. So I think you have, you know, you have enough resources, and you could, like, you know, get into it and, you know, figure it out.
Yeah. Oh, guys, thank you so, so much. It's been such a joy to speak to you all. And thank you for sharing your experiences. And to everyone watching, thank you for joining us. And we hope you've enjoyed all of our answers, and that's been really helpful for you. If you have anything more you want to ask, please do just reach out to us. We are all here to help you and support you in making your decisions about what you might want to do. We're going to finish our session now hearing from just one more student who's going to tell us a little bit more about her experience. So we'll say thank you very much and goodbye for now. And we hope you enjoyed it, and we'll hope to see you soon. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Duras Nahala. I'm from Bangladesh. I've been living in Dumfries for 8 months now and studying at the University of Glasgow. As we all know, climate change is an important issue right now, and it is actually impacting countries like Bangladesh, developing countries. So this actually motivated me to do my undergrad in environmental management. And after that, I really want to expand my knowledge on environmental management. So I chose this program, which is risk management. Coming over was a challenge, obviously, because meeting new people, getting used to the accent and everything, but we have 9 students in one class. So it was really easy to get along with everyone because people around here are very friendly. I lived in a city in Bangladesh, and it was really chaotic. Biggest difference is there is less people over here, and it's very peaceful. And also, where I lived in Dhaka, it's kind of surrounded with buildings only, no green spaces. And whereas in Dumfries, green spaces are more and less people. The campus is nature-centric, and this is what I love all the time, like to be close to nature. I love hills, I love mountains, and Dumfries is near that, and it made me interested to apply for this program. I really wanted to find myself somewhere where I can sit by myself and think and spend some time in the nature. So this is the best place, I would say. I see myself settling here because it's my comfort zone.